So I want to go deep with you today. Okay, we're going to go deep into a truth. You know, Bible truth are circles that intertwine with each other, and then they go deeper, some of them, and they become just hard to even comprehend. By faith, the Holy Spirit has to make them alive to us, and there's nothing deeper than what I'm about to talk about now in your Christian life. And I pray that it will be a blessing to you. I want to talk about His deepest work in our lives, in your life and my life. You know, when you become a Christian, God goes to work in your life, whether you want it or not, whether you're aware of it, whether I'm aware of it. God has certain goals in our life. It's called the will of God, the purpose of God. And He's working toward that. And you and I might get distracted and go off over here or go off over there, but God's not changing. No, He's got His plan for Taranda's life, Carol, myself, He's you. We're just, He's focused in on that. And how that all works out is a very deep thing. So in Philippians chapter 2, Paul is writing to a church that he founded, and he's talking to them about how great Jesus is in the early chapters, the humility of Jesus in chapter 2, and then he writes this. Therefore, verse 12 of chapter 2, therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence. Let's just stop there for a second. So what he's saying is this. Now, when I was with you and I was your pastor and I was working with you, you know, I had hands on and you were trying to follow what I was teaching. But now I'm not with you. But don't stop in your focus on your Christian life. Don't stop. I'm not with you. Now even more focus in. Because at the heart of Christianity is not who's your pastor, who's your teacher, what books have you read. At the heart of Christianity is our personal relationship with Jesus Christ. The intimacy that we have with Him. The openness we have with Him. The walk that we have with Him. How He speaks to us. How we open our hearts to Him. Christianity is super, super personal. Although God does put us in community in the body of Christ, He loves and wants that close, intimate relationship with us. And no teacher or pastor can be a substitute for that. In fact, they can become a hindrance. There are people who are listening more to what the pastor is saying than what the Word of God and Jesus is saying. So Paul is just reminding them, remember now, I'm not with you, but don't take the pedal off the metal here. Just press it. Be focused. Now what? Now comes some very mysterious words. Work out your salvation. Continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. We're going to go on, but let's just stop there because that throws a lot of us totally off. What do you mean, work out your salvation with fear and trembling? Taranda just sang hallelujah to the Lamb. We know that salvation is a gift, not by works. So why is Paul saying, work out your salvation? Can we do something to get us accepted with God? Impossible. The whole teaching of the New Testament is that by the works of the law, by my behavior patterns, by my meritocracy, by me earning points with God, no one will ever be accepted by God. If you try to obey the law good enough for God to say, good, you're good to go, you've been really good. You got some weak areas, but for the most part, you're good enough to go to heaven. Most of America in polling shows that people believe in America that if I live a good life, I'm going to go to heaven. That's not why we go to heaven. We go to heaven because we've received the gift of salvation through our faith in Jesus Christ. Can we say a loud amen with clapping? That's why we're going there. So There are a multitude of verses. Not by works, lest anyone should boast. For we are justified by faith, God's grace. He gave the gift of Christ, and faith is nothing more than the hand that receives the gift. That's all. I'm saved because Christ was offered. I heard the message. I believed, and my faith is the hand that just takes it. Or you sit down at the table that's already prepared for you. You can't boast in anything. The table was prepared for you. The gift was offered to you. Nobody can boast. No one's boasting in heaven. Everyone's saying hallelujah to the Lamb. He is my salvation. So then what's Paul talking about? Work out your salvation. And then on top of that, with fear and trembling. What is going on? Well, let's break down the word salvation. Salvation has basically three meanings in the New Testament. There's the onset of salvation, the initial act of believing. On that day, he got saved. On that day, she received Christ. So that's salvation beginning. They were saved that day. You follow? Then the word is used in another sense. It's a process. Working. The Bible talks about we're being kept by God. His salvation is an ongoing process, which we often call sanctification. Because once you come into God's family, once you're saved and you put your faith in Christ, once you're born again, God has an unchangeable will. He wants to change me and you into the image of Jesus Christ. He wants to make us talk like Christ, react like Christ, love like Christ, show mercy like Christ. That is his goal. Nobody can opt out of that. Some have a gift to preach or do music or sing like Tarenda or whatever, but all of us, God wants to conform us to the image of his son, because he also knows that will not only glorify him, but that's the happiest you are in life when you're the most like Christ. Holiness is not a negative word. Holiness equals happiness. It's sin that ruins our joy and our peace. So God is intent on changing, shaping, and making us more like Christ. That's another process of salvation, another phase of it. Then there's another way salvation is used. As we eagerly wait for the salvation that's going to be revealed. Well, wait, how can I wait for something I already have? No, when Christ returns and we go to heaven, then salvation will be totally complete. New bodies. No more temptation. No more devil. No more dying. No more pain. No more crying. That's the ultimate of the final stage of salvation, to be with the Lord forever. So there's the onset of it, there's the process of salvation, and then there is the final step into glory to be with the Lord. So now let's go back to the verse. So Paul says, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Work it out. Focus on it. Be careful with it. Be reverent in it. The word fear there means awe and reverence, not cringing fear, but awe and reverence. And with trembling, we don't trust in ourselves. We know everything that has to be done, God has to do it. So now what's he saying here? How can you work out something that's already been done? But it's still being done. And then there's a final day coming. So listen, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Why? For it's God who works in you, both to will and to do according to his good pleasure and purpose. So what's happening here? Paul is saying, you got to remember, be reverent about the thing, be focused, be careful, be watchful, be wakeful. Don't fall asleep. Why? Because God is at work inside of you. Now, you will never read a verse like that anywhere in the Old Testament under the law. In the law, where God dwelt, for the most part, was in the Holy of Holies. in the tabernacle and later in the temple. That's where God dwelt, his Shekinah presence. But through Jesus Christ, we not only have forgiveness of our past sins, but now when you're born again, I become the dwelling place of God. For it is God who works in you. Paul says in one of the Corinthian letters, don't you know that Christ Jesus is in you? Don't you know that? In Romans chapter 8, Paul says, if anyone doesn't have the Spirit of Christ, he doesn't belong to Christ. The proof of being a Christian is not going to church or understanding doctrine. It's that the Holy Spirit comes to live inside of you. That's why the Bible says, don't grieve the Spirit. Don't quench the Spirit. Now just think of that. I've been in awe of that for 3 or 4 days now. Inside of me dwells Almighty God. Inside of you is the Holy Spirit. You might have not thought about it. You might not think about it. From day to day, you maybe read through the verse and then it didn't apply it to yourself. Paul says, Christ in me, the hope of glory. Not Christ in heaven only, he is in heaven. But through the Holy Spirit, Christ is in you. He's in me. I'm not feeling love up here. I said, Christ is in us. He's in us. Almighty God is living inside of me. When you become a Christian, you've been born again and the Spirit takes up residence. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Not just the church collectively, but Paul says in the Corinthian letters that our bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit. Just think, Almighty God who created the heavens and earth with that power lives inside of me. Just think of that. We hardly ever think of that and apply it. We're always just waking up and, well, let me try to do what's right today. That's not the Christian life. Paul says, why you have to be reverent and give attention to this? Because Almighty God is inside of you, in you. Notice, in your heart. Someone once said, your whole life is your heart. Because when your heart is at peace and God is working in your heart and you recognize that, it doesn't matter if you have 2 nickels to rub together. You're happy. But when your heart is bad, you could be at the best steakhouse or be on a vacation in Hawaii and you're miserable. Why? Because as your heart is, that's what you are. Money won't change it. Sex can't change it. Drugs can't change it. The only thing that makes you happy is Christ in your heart. Come on, let's say amen to that in my heart. Before I go on and just apply this mystery of him working in us, just let's stop and think about that. I've been thinking a lot about it and shed many tears in the last few days alone. The Holy Spirit lives inside of me, lives inside of you. That means everything you look at, he has to look at. Everything you read, he has to read it with you. Everything you do, behind closed doors or not, he's a part of that. Everything you say, he has to listen. Every bitter word, every gossip, every critical thing you do, he lives inside you. He's not 7 million miles away. He lives inside of you. He lives inside of me. We're his temple. The shame of that in my life as I look back to when I received Christ as a teenager, preteen almost. Oh my goodness. That'll change everything, the way you talk, the way you act, the way you react, if you're just conscious. Almighty God lives inside of me. What a blessing, what a privilege. God's not looking for some temple to be built in Jerusalem. We're his temples. He's not going to go back to a building when he left the building thousands of years ago. We're the temple. Someone once said that when Einstein, the genius and the scientist, physicist, whatever he was, who helped, he came to America prior to World War II because he fled the Nazis, him being Jewish. He was born in Switzerland. And he got to America and he was part of the famous Manhattan Project, which was the creation of the atomic bomb that was dropped on Japan at the end of the war to hopefully bring the war to a close, which it did. Well, he was so famous that he had a house out in California, a very modest home. But people would drive all over the place just to try to get near, and they'd go, look, see that? See the brick house? Einstein lives there. The house ain't much, but Einstein lives in there. Would to God we would live in such a way that people would say, he ain't all that, but Jesus lives inside of him. Just think, no, God lives inside of him. Almighty God lives inside of him. No unbeliever can say that. No one of another religion can say that. That teaching was unheard of in the Old Testament, that we would be the temple. So just think what some of us have put him through. By the way, that's the way you know a real Christian. A Christian can't live practicing sin. Not a real Christian. No, the Holy Spirit will just send you into just the worst kind of pain you've ever known. How many know what I'm talking about? You don't have to raise your hand, but you can say amen. A person who glibly said, I go to church, but yeah, I've been fornicating, sleeping around and all that. But you know, God loves me and it makes me happy. And I, no, don't be judgmental. Don't be a hater. That person doesn't know the Holy Spirit. Am I correct? Oh, when the Holy Spirit is working strong in your life and you're listening to him, just one wrong little sentence, boom. Come on, do I get a witness here? He just quickened you. Whoa, I shouldn't have said that. What did I say that for? Oh, Lord, forgive me. But, so here, let me close with this. Why does he live inside of us? Now that we're going deep now, there's nothing deeper than this. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Pay attention. You're not going to earn your salvation. You're already saved. But now that you're saved, don't you want to live a life that makes the Lord happy? Who would love someone and not want to make them happy? So the whole enticement to live a godly life is to make the Lord happy, not in order to get saved. We are saved. But now we want to live. How many want to live a life and talk and act in a way that makes Jesus happy? Just lift your hand. Of course, if you love someone, you know. So work it out. Concentrate. Work with the one who's working in you. Cooperate with that working. Well, what is he doing? He's in you, working. The word is different than the first working. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works, energizes, brings to completion, effectually brings about the willing and the doing according to his good pleasure. Why is God inside of me? Because he knows how hopelessly weak and helpless I am. And the only way that he can change me is by giving me, through the Spirit working in me, new desires that are foreign to Jim Cimbala. Because all my desires end up having something to do with self. So it's God who works in you. This is mysterious. It's always me. It's my will. Human responsibility is always there. But underneath everything, it's God who's working in you to will, to change what you want, to give you new desires, to want what Jesus wants. Otherwise, how do we live the Christian life? We're always battling against that resistant will of mine. And we're always making promises. And I'm going to change. It's like going on a diet until the Oreo cookies are brought in on the plate. And then adios, dieta. Why? Didn't you just say to yourself, you have to be on a diet? It's healthy. Don't you know that? Aren't you intelligent? Aren't I intelligent enough to know I shouldn't eat that? Then why am I putting it in my mouth? Because that's what's in me. But here's what God says. I'll work in you, both to will and to do. I'll give you new desires. They'll be your desires, but underneath, they're really my desires that I'm working in you. What does that look like? For example, God wants to be close to us and see us grow in faith. So he knows that the only way we're going to grow and be strong in faith and walk by faith and be a blessing to others is we have to live in this word. Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word. But I talk to people all the time since I went in the ministry. I don't like to read. I dropped out of school. I don't like to read. Well, did you read? Did you do your devotions today? Yeah, I read a verse. How long did it take? 20 seconds. I like to look at my phone. I like to follow sports. Or I like whatever, politics and all that stuff. But the Bible, look, other people are more like that. They like to read all that. No. So you know what God starts to do? He puts a hunger in you. And he puts a desire in you. Oh, I got to read his word today. Wow, I never felt that before. Is that me? No, it's you. But it's God working in you, putting a new desire in you so that you have to get up in the middle of the night, which has happened to me at times. You know what? Just something in me said, you didn't get enough food today, spiritual food. You get up and you start to read the word. You meditate on it day and night. Oh, the godly person who's blessed by God, he meditates on his word day and night. But I don't really like reading the Bible. Well, you got those carnal tendencies that we all have. So now work it out. Let God work in you. Trust him. Talk to him. Say to him, God, put those desires in me for the good things that you want from my life. To overcome those selfish, stupid desires that I have that go nowhere. Work in me both to will. Take another thing. God wants us to draw near to him and see him answer our prayers. I don't like to pray. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. Should I die? What a prayer that was when kids were little, right? Should I die before I wake? I pray the Lord my soul to take. Other people pray. I'm not into it. God says, now work it out. Work with me. Cooperate with me. Focus. Trust me. Surrender to me. Start the day and say, Lord, have your way in my life. Spirit of God, you're not in there for nothing. You're in there for something. Work out your desires in my life. I want pure things. I want to love holy things. I want to love to pray. I want to love to worship. Like you came to church today. Just think, why did you come to church today? A lot of other people aren't going to church. What made that desire go in you? That's God. God was working in you. Come on, do I get a witness? God was working in you that post-pandemic. And a lot of people, and we respect that, a little leery of it, you're here today because you had a desire to be here today. Who put that desire in you? Because there was a day when you didn't care about going to church. So what changed you? What put that new desire? Oh, God, at work in us, both to will and to do. Take one more situation. Someone's hurt you. And you have enmity, you have anger, you have resentment, you have bitterness toward a person or a group of people or a race. You know it's wrong. You're a Christian. And you read the Bible, forgive even as I have forgiven you. And your head goes, yeah, but inside goes, nope. I ain't forgiven nobody for nothing. And you can live like that. and you get all dry inside, and you lose your witness for Christ, and you lose your joy and your peace, because how can you be bitter and angry with people or be fussing and fighting on social media and have the blessing of God on your life? That's impossible. Jesus would never do that. Am I right or wrong here? But how do you stop? He can give you a desire, instead of being angry at the person, to pray for the person. No, I ain't praying for her. No, I'm not praying for her. I'm not praying for him. If you only knew what he did. You ever have someone do one of those Brooklyn things? If you only knew what he did. And it's hopeless if you just try to do it by self-will. How many understand what I'm talking about? Just lift your hand. If you try to do it by self-will, you're always just pounding yourself. Come on, change, change. But how can a leopard change his spots? I'm a leopard. I ain't changing my spots. But God gives you the Spirit. Oh, and Christ was on the cross. And he said, Father, forgive them. Forgive who? The people crucifying him. How many want that Spirit in you? How many want those desires in you? Otherwise, what we have is, you did me, I'll do you. You get me, I'll get back at you. What a terrible way to live. You are Alpha and Omega, if you could play that, brother. So, by the way, one last one. This is the deepest thing. This is Christ working in us. This is what Jesus said, abide in me. I'm the vine, you're the branches. Let that sap, the life sap, just flow into you, and it'll bear forth fruit. It won't be the branch that does it. It's the sap that does it. You cut that branch away from the sap, the vine dies. Some secret sin, some habit, something that just tormenting you, just has you in a hammerlock. Christians, great Christians, have testified, gone through periods of fighting it, promising God, no more. I'm going to fast. I'm going to pray. I'm going to try to read more of the Bible. And then that ugly thing just rears its head. It's like nothing ever changes. Then you start to wonder, did I ever really change? Am I a Christian? What's going on? And God says, listen, let me work in you. Let me work in you. I'll give you different desires. I'll change those desires. Those dire desires will be overcome by new desires that I'll give you. And you'll have the victory, not because it's you, but because it's me working in you. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Strengthens me where? Inside, in my heart. Where comes the issues of life? So, what victory comes? What peace? What release? What relief comes? It's not my job to live the Christian life. He not only died on the cross and became my righteousness and wiped away all my sin, but now as I go ahead in life, he says, no, I don't want you to just do anything. What I did on the cross through my son, now I'm going to do in your heart through the Holy Spirit. I'm going to make you like my son, and it won't be you doing it. I don't want you to try in your strength to be what you should be. Let me live through you, through the Holy Spirit. I'll produce fruit in you. You won't even recognize yourself. What happened with Callie, the girl I was just talking about? Why is she now happy and joyful and singing praise and worship from that one who wanted to take her life and cutting herself? And, that's the other thing she had. She was drinking, mixing all kinds of alcohol. I made her pour out all the bottles and throw away all the pills. Why is she a new person now? It's the same Callie, but it's not the same Callie. God is working in her. Come on, say amen with me. God is working in her. She has new desires. She has new desires. She has new power to say no to temptation. For it's God who works in you both to will and to do according to his pleasure. So you have a burden here today of, Pastor Symbol, I'm in this like treadmill. The more I try, the less I change. God says this. Now work out your salvation. Pay attention now. Because my Spirit is inside of you. Oh, blessed Holy Spirit. Aren't you happy the Holy Spirit lives inside of you? And he's there with his power and his strength and his gentleness and his kindness and his love. No, I could never love like that. Yes, you can. He'll love through you. It won't be your love. It'll be his love. People will think it's your love, but it's really his love. It's his kindness. Even though you're acting kind, people will say, you're so kind. Oh, if they only knew, right? It's God who works in you. Oh, I want God working in me. How about you? You are Alpha and Omega. We worship you, Lord. You are to me. Right where you're sitting, just lift up one hand. Lift up one hand and sing to him. Close your eyes. Dismiss. Could there be someone here today? You're hearing what I'm preaching from the Word of God, and you're saying, I can identify with a lot of that, but I don't get other parts of it. It might be because you might be religious, you might be Catholic, Protestant, whatever, but you've never had the miracle happen of being born again, confessing your sins, putting your faith in Christ, where you become an actual temple of the Holy Spirit. So now you're fighting the battles of life on your own strength, and you find them too meager, too weak, insufficient, can't make it. You need peace, it's not there. You want joy and strength, you want resolve, you want victory, you want solidity, and everything is just loose. I would love if it was just one of you that I could pray for today. The other people will be able to go, but if you're here today and say, Pastor, I want that experience in my life. I want to know that God is working in me. Him working in me. Not me struggling, Him working. Both to will and to do. Just come out of your seat right now. Just come quickly, because I want to just pray over you. Let the other people go. Anyone here, just come. Come out of your seat. Thank you. Come right to the front. Right here. I'm so thankful for you. I am thankful for you. And for this person too. Anybody else want to come? Come on, come close. I'm not asking you to join the church. Don't want your money. I want you to have Jesus. I want you to have Jesus. There's still some other coming. Let's sing this as the last song. Ready? You give you all. Let's sing loud, everyone. We give you all glory. We worship you, Lord. You are worthy. Every eye closed, congregation, let's help them. There's eight of them here in the front. Thank God for every one of them. So you eight people, repeat after me, but the congregation is going to pray out loud too. So everybody repeat after me, but you in the front especially, so please. Dear God, thank you for loving me and sending your Son to die for my sins. I believe in Jesus, that He is the Son of God. I make Him my Savior today. I put my trust in Him. Forgive me for my sins. Cleanse me. Give me a new heart. Come and live inside of me, as you promised in your word. Make me the person you've always wanted me to be. For I pray simply in the name of Jesus. Amen. Can we thank God for all these beautiful people? So, listen, all of you, we have no cards to hand out or anything like that, but I just want you to know we love you. If you can come Tuesday night to the prayer meeting at 6:30, look for me. I want to give you all a hug and say hello to you, okay? So remember the memorial service today at 3:00. Everyone turn around, hug someone, say hello. Singers, would you come down there and just say hello to my friends there? Thank you.